Welcome, delegates, to another exciting session at Gator 2021, Digital Gaming, the Next Leap. Today's Five Chat topic discussion is on, can India become an online skills gaming superpower? The moderator for the session is Mugdha Varia, business journalist, CNBC TV 18. And the speaker for today's session is Mr. Bhavin Pandya, co-founder and CEO, Games 24/7. I'd like to hand it over to Mugdha to start the discussion. And delegates, please look forward to an exciting discussion today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Soham. And a very good morning to all of you. And just at the onset, I want to say that this is the first gaming event that I am becoming a part of. And I'm really looking forward to learning a lot through the course of the day at this event today. And with me is none other than Bhavin Pandya, co-founder and CEO at Games 24/7, one of the pioneers of skill gaming, online skill gaming in India. And the topic, like Soham said, that we're going to discuss today is whether India can become an online skill gaming superpower. So very ambitious topic to start off with. Bhavin, my first question to you, and before we start, I can also ask the delegates to put in questions in the chat box under the Q&A section. We can take up questions from there. Bhavin, let's start. My first question to you is, you know, how much has the pandemic accelerated India's journey towards becoming a superpower in online skill gaming? Has it really been the tipping point for the gaming sector in India?
First of all, thank you very much, Mugdha, and to IMAI for giving us this opportunity to share our views and thoughts with you know, with the industry, with attendees and the industries at large. To answer your question, my view is, having been in this space for a while now, my view has always has been and continues to be that India was always always there. India was always at a point where we were going to become the next gaming superpower, right? And this was fueled by two things, three things mainly. One is our young and vibrant population, right? We have a young working population, which is sort of larger than most countries put together, right? So I think that has sort of really augured well for us, coupled with the internet, right? The way the internet is spreading through mobile devices, through smartphones, that I think is also playing a very, very important role in how digital gaming, online gaming is taking on. And I think ease of payments with UPI and others like them, right, that are enabling UPI to sort of have very very seamless ways to make payments, I think is what has always been the drivers of growth for this gaming industry. What the pandemic has done, to more directly answer your question, what the pandemic has done is really brought gaming into the forefront much more than it has been, right? It has always shown the numbers, it has always shown the data to grow like it is expected to grow, but the pandemic has made it a buzzword, has made it, you know, a talking point, right? Like Mr. Ranjan before me said, that he saw himself playing a lot more games during the pandemic, right? And I'm sure a lot of us did think that, okay, now I have all this time, I can't get out of the house, what do I really do, right? I can do, you know, multiple things, and gaming is one of them that has sort of really taken a front seat. So I think we were always on the cusp of becoming that gaming superpower, and I really think we're there. What the pandemic has done is just made a lot more people aware of it, right? Okay. And that's how I get to answer that question. Yeah.
My follow-up question to this then is, like you said, there was more time for everyone and people were looking for some kind of entertainment, etc. With the economy reopening and people going back to offices, etc., do you see any impact on the time spent on gaming, or do you think that's going to stick, the fact that people have enjoyed playing these games?
That's a very, very good question, Mugdha. Thank you for asking that. It's generally, as they said, it's never what really meets the eye. So multiple things are playing out here. First and foremost, when the pandemic hit, there were a lot of players who were fence sitters, who were, you know, thinking about, should I try this, should I not try this? A lot more of those people tried the game, right? A lot more people started playing. That's why it really became the buzzword, because those that had nothing to do with gaming were now playing games, right? Now, as things have started opening up, two things have happened. One, a lot of the fence sitters have left, saying that, okay, I have to get back to my regular work and do other things, right? But a bunch of them have stayed on, saying that, oh, this is really good. I'm going to take out time from my daily routine as a stress buster or for other reasons, just continue to playing these games. So we've seen both those effects. So while the pandemic did bring in an inflow of people, and while the easing of the lockdown has taken away some of them, there is a permanent increase in the number of players and the engagement that we're seeing overall. And I think this is true for the industry, not just for us.
Absolutely. I think the new normal will be the fact that there are people who are going to now play more games regularly.
That's right.
You know,
that's
you right. talked about the fact that what has really helped the gaming sector is the youth population, the internet penetration, digital payments adoption, etc. My next question was about the key drivers for growth of the gaming sector. And while you've talked about these, what are some of the other key drivers that are necessary for the sector to grow, including funding, including regulatory clarity? What will really push India to become a superpower in online scale gaming?
Sure. So Mugda, I'll probably take a step back and talk a little bit about what online skill gaming really is, right? There are all kinds of gaming. There's casual gaming, skill gaming, other kinds of gaming. But what online skill gaming does, right, is really it takes a person who really thinks that they have the skill for a particular game or for a particular activity, right, and challenges them to test themselves against other players who are like them, right? And how does it challenge them? It challenges them by saying that, all right, you put in a small amount of money to really see if you're better than that player or not, right? Very much like the US Open that just concluded, right? You have so many elite players paying an entry fee coming into the tournament, and then one player saying, I'm the best, right? And will take away most of the prize pool that came in as entry fees, right? So it's like that, right? And what has really become an issue here, right, is that, and this is again something that Mr. Ranjan spoke about, is that, okay, what is really a game of skill? And when you talk about skill gaming industry, can you just take any game and say, okay, you test your skill? If there is no skill in a game, then how can you call it skill gaming, right, for example? And I think a lot of, and this is the big problem, a lot of people have started coupling skill gaming and all kinds of gaming together, but they're not. They're very different. You know, skill gaming is a legitimate form of entertainment, which is constitutionally protected, which the courts have sort of said, including the latest Madras High Court judgment, said again and again that people can play. So I think that this clarity, right, the more this clarity sort of percolates down, the industry will be helped significantly. Because in today, most of the revenue that is being generated is generated from the skill gaming industry, from the online skill gaming industry. The revenue is not coming from other forms of gaming, right? It's coming from the skill gaming industry. Take the top 5-10 players, they're all skill gaming, online skill gaming players or operators, right? And so that's, I think that clarity, right, will come in two ways. One, obviously, people will go to the court and the courts will provide clarity. But more importantly, right, I think two things need to happen. One, what the Telangana government under Mr. Jayesh Ranjan's leadership is doing is to say that, okay, let's regulate. We know that skill gaming is a constitutional right. Let's figure out how we can offer that without letting the scrupulous guys also operate. The games of chance guys, the betting guys, gambling guys, with stopping them, how do we still go and offer our services, right? So I think that is one thing. And the other thing is, centrally, if the government, the Indian government, can say, okay, these are online games of skill, they are protected under the constitution, therefore at the center they're protected, that no state can sort of take these one-off measures to say that, okay, you can't play this game in my state, right? That will help tremendously. And I think the industry is working at large to make sure that the center recognizes this space, by putting it either in the concurrent list or some list where they can sort of judge over it and legislate over it, and that's, I think, that will make a difference. And in addition to that, obviously the enablers are there by way of our young population, the internet proliferation, digital payments, right? But I think this big piece of the government sort of coming in and recognizing that this is a huge industry that we can be in the on the forefront of, you know, made in India for the world, right? That kind of a narrative, right? I think that's regulation is the biggest part that will help us. And the funding is there, right? The investors understand the potential of this space, right? And there is a lot of opportunity both for investments, investors, but also for folks that are trying to raise money, folks that are trying to obtain funding. So right now, I think the future is very bright. All we need to take care of or think about or ponder over is how we can regulate this space, in a better way.
No, absolutely. I think you put it very succinctly. And, you know, the fact that you talked about the Madras High Court judgment, there are several court judgments which have recognized online skill gaming. But like you said, there is no overarching central regulation or clarity as of now on online skill gaming and recognizing online skill gaming. You said you're working with the government, the industry is working with the government. You know, what more needs to be done? What are the parallels that can be drawn with other countries where online skill gaming has been recognized and has thrived because of government regulatory clarity?
So that's again very very pertinent question, right? So when we talk to the lawmakers, the decision makers, the regulators, right, their main concern is twofold. They have two concerns, right? One is how do we know that this is a game of skill, right? How do we know that a player truly has to use his skill and do this, right? That's one. And the second one is, how do we know that there are no unscrupulous operators that will take, say, a player's money and go away, or they'll sort of, you know, do other things that will harm the industry, right? Mr. Ranjan also spoke of addiction, etc., right? How do we make sure that these things don't happen? And the West has handled this very well. The way the West has regulated, especially the UK and other countries in Europe, the way they've handled it is they've said that, look, you need to obtain a license from me, right? And for this license, once you take this license from me, I will let you operate under specific conditions, right? And then I will audit you from time to time to make sure that these conditions that I've laid out under which you've received the license, right, are being followed by you. And that has helped the industry thrive. That has helped the population immensely, because they know that they're protected by the government, that if they're going and playing an online game of skill, that they know that the operator is legitimate, that their monies are safe, that they're actually just going there to entertain themselves and they are not sort of, you know, going overboard. So those are some of the things that I think we need to start looking at in India as well. A government body or some body needs to be established to say that, okay, I'm going to offer this license, and with this license you can do A, B, C, D, and E, but you can't do X, Y, and Z. And then to audit that, to monitor that on a timely basis. And I think that's what will really help us, grow as an industry in India.
A regulatory body then could help the sector. And since we're talking about regulations, regulatory clarifications, the industry is also seeking some clarifications on GST, on whether it's going to be charged on platform fees or on the overall sale value. What is happening there? The GST Council is going to meet soon. What have the discussions been like with the government on GST clarifications?
Sure. So Mukta, you know, let me start there by saying this, right, that every time we don't understand something, right, we have more questions. Every time we don't something doesn't make sense to us, right, we try to sort of have a discussion around, we try to sort of figure out, okay, what do I do, right? And I think gaming finds itself in that space, right? Someone has asked me many times, I mean, other people have asked me many times, right, like, that why does GST have to specifically meet for gaming, right? Doesn't gaming fall into the services category where it is taxed like everything else, right? And my response to that is exactly this, that yes, it does, but it is new, it is alien, it is different for a lot of people. You know, this whole transfer of digital goods in some areas is okay, but in some other areas is sort of something that's more nuanced, that needs more work. And therefore, the industry or the government bodies need to meet to make sure that, again, there is no misuse of any of the services that have been provided, or that the government is also able to very transparently recognize what services have been provided and therefore tax them appropriately, right? And I think that's why these meetings happen. That's why this clarity is needed, because every type of game is different. The way the companies generate revenue through these games is also different in some cases. And for the government to get a handle of all of these things, right, get there, really understand, okay, what game is generating revenue on what basis, right, is what I think calls for these meetings and deliberations. And I think we're at least very confident, based on precedent, based on law, based on how the other countries are doing it, right, that that the government will see that, okay, this is how these things should be categorized, that the law that currently exists is overarching, is complete, is holistic, is comprehensive, that it does also have space for gaming and nothing special needs to be made for that. That's at least our view at this time.
Absolutely. So some more clarifications needed there. Coming to the funding part, like you said, you know, funding has been there for the sector. But what is the role of FDI that you see for the growth of the sector? We are also now seeing unicorns emerge from the gaming space. There are a lot of unicorns waiting in the pipeline. How do you see the sector evolve in the next 5 years?
So my personal view is obviously going to be a biased view because I'm in this space, right? I think we're poised for immense growth. You know, just the last 8 to 12 months, the kind of growth you know, the industry has seen, in particular some gaming companies have seen, right, have really catapulted their valuations and really sort of given investors a lot of confidence about investing in this space, right? See, two things happen when investors come in, right? Old investors get exits, right, which means that they realize their money, they've invested at a particular valuation, that valuation increases, so they get their money that is returned. And it makes, as the valuation increases, right, it sets the tone for further increase in valuation, right, as companies continue to grow. And I think right now we're living in a world that's very optimistic. You know, everything is priced well, if I may say so. And I think for some time at least that will continue. I think our and gaming in India will continue to grow, in my view, again on the back of very macroeconomic factors that are working well for India, right? Its population, its digital payments, its proliferation of the internet, and so I think that's going to really encourage investors, bring more funding, more FDI into the country. But again, everything comes back to that one point, Mukta, which is that they will also need some clarity, right? It can't be that they invest in this space and then one state says that you got to stop operating, right?
Yeah.
So those are some of the things that we'll have to think about.
Absolutely. So funding, of course, will follow regulatory clarity as well. And since the clock is ticking, you know, one final question I want to ask you about is international expansion and global ambitions of gaming players in India, because Indian gaming companies are building products for international markets as well. In fact, Games 24/7, I understand, is also looking at expansion in the United States. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and whether this will really be the moment of making India for the world? Can you just talk about the whole international global expansion for the gaming sector?
Sure, absolutely. So the way this is happening, and I'll sort of first speak for the industry, right? The industry is trying to make very good, engaging, you know, high fidelity games that will go out there and that will sort of mesmerize the world, right? Made in India for the world, right? But that part has been slightly hard, right? I think there are international players, gaming operators, gaming companies, right, that are that are really leading the way in terms of innovation, in terms of graphics, in terms of how you can produce highly engaging and entertaining games, right? India has some ways to go there. I think we're not there yet. Of course, you know, like you said, at Games 24/7, we're trying that through our Ultimate Games brand, trying that to say that, okay, we are going to go out there and offer casual games to the Western world, right? So some of those things are happening through us, through some of the other players. But to do online skill gaming in other countries, right, would mean that you have to abide by their rules, you have to follow their regulations. And you know, as they say, all good things take time. So I think that will take slightly longer. But as far as casual games are concerned, where you just go and play because you enjoy the game, I think India has to develop some more capability there before it can compete with the world.
Okay, so you're saying casual gaming will expand faster because of the lower regulatory oversight
Yes,
on casual.
there we will need skill upliftment. That will
Yeah.
be therefore easier to do. But I'm sure right now, given how as a global economy we're expanding, I'm sure there are opportunities in other spaces too.
All right, Bhavin, I think it's time to wrap the discussion, but always great
Thank you.
learning at this event. Good talking to you. With that, it's over to
You
you,
too,
Soham.
Mukta. Thank you.
Thank you, Bhavin. Thank you, Mukta, for a very exciting and a very interesting discussion. We'd like to end this session by thanking our partners, our title partner, Games24/7, powered by partner AppsFlyer, in association with Trackier, platinum partner, OnePlus, content delivery partner, Limelight Networks, supported by Invest India, and knowledge partner, Redseer. Delegates, please look forward to the upcoming sessions at Gator 2021, and thank you, Mukta and Bhavin, for a wonderful
Thank
discussion.
you,
Thank you.
Soham. Thank you, Aimee. Thanks, Mukta. Bye.
Bye.